So now that we know how to edit the attributes and the geometries of vector data, a complementary skill is using their fields for visualization. As we briefly introduced, these parameters can be set in the layer properties box. Today we'll focus on the Symbology tab, learning the available styles and their application to different field types. Then in a follow-up video, we'll show how to use rule-based visualizations, save and load created Symbology files, and apply labeling schemes. Before beginning, let's discuss some considerations for visualization. First, are there established conventions for symbolizing the specific features in a layer? If there are multiple conventions, which is best aligned with the geographic location being visualized? Second, have you selected logical color schemes for the specific features? Third, what is the appropriate style based on the field type? And then some additional factors that influence interpretability, such as enhancing the contrast between different features and layers, the number of features and level of detail relative to the scale, to avoid creating overcrowded or oversimplified visualizations. The simplest symbology edits can be done by right-clicking the layer, expanding style, and dragging on the color wheel to change the color. Using the white circle, we can also alter the specific hue and brightness. So this is already an improvement for this layer, being immediately decipherable as water features. Now let's explore the single symbol style, the default in QGIS, where a single color is applied to all features using our boundary layers. Specifically, we'll alter the styles to visualize both boundary levels simultaneously. So opening the layer property box in the Symbology tab, we can change the color or transparency of the entire layer, as we just did with our hydrological layer, using these tabs. However, we want to change only the transparency of the fill color, retaining the boundary outlines, so we'll click on Simple Fill and then Fill Color. We can use the sliders on the right or the interactive selections in the various tabs to set the applied color. For our purpose, we will set the opacity to 0, making our layer fully transparent. Then we can use Apply to verify we're satisfied with the visualization and OK to finalize. Now we'll repeat with the sense of division layer, going to Simple Fill and changing the outline width to 0.86. And then clicking on the color will also alter it to red to distinguish them from the subdivision boundaries. Now, as seen in the canvas, we can visualize both boundaries simultaneously. Alternatively, we could have applied a categorized symbology, which enables us to symbolize discrete features, classes, or categories within a specified field selected in the column dropdown. Using the provincial unique identifier, we can click Classify and Apply. So now each subdivision is colored according to its province. We could switch this out for another categorical variable, like the census division names, hitting Classify, Yes, and OK. So this offers an alternative means to visualize both boundary levels. But due to the random color ramp, there are two issues. The first being adjacent features may be assigned similar colors, complicating their distinction. And the second, the applied colors may not enhance contrast between features or be aesthetically pleasing to interpret. So we'll use some color presets within the Symbology tab and the Topological Coloring tool in the Processing Toolbox to address these issues. So the Topological Coloring tool is explicitly meant for symbolizing boundaries and will ensure adjacent features are not assigned the same color. Within the tool, we'll specify the input layer, the number of colors to use, and the mode, which determines how colors are assigned and are explained in the tool description on the right. We'll use assigned area, helpful given the variations in the size of features in divisions, and even more pertinent for our subdivision layer. The tool outputs a new layer with the exact same properties as the input, except with one new field called Color ID, which we can use for visualization. Selecting it from the dropdown, we will now expand the dropdown beside the random color ramp and select Create New. Here are a variety of presets available for symbolizing a layer. Today we'll use the Catalog Color Brewer. So, first we'll just match the number of colors to that specified in the tool, and then we can select a color scheme including the palettes and ramps to use, in this case, Pastel 1. Then click OK. Now adjacent features are distinctly colored and the overall visualization is much easier to interpret. Now let's explore graduated symbologies using the grain elevators layer. Graduated styles can be used to visualize concentrations, magnitudes, or frequencies of a variable with a specific color ramp, like vehicle collisions, earthquakes, and population sizes. The style is restricted to numeric field types, so we'll use the capacity ton field. The mode determines the method used to establish value ranges or break values used in visualization. So we can use pretty breaks, which defaults to easily interpretable value ranges. The precision parameter determines the number of decimal places in the legend values, and we can also alter the classes in the bottom right corner to determine the number of value ranges used in visualization. Clicking Apply and looking in the canvas, nearly all of our elevators are colored white, with select elevators on the coasts being colored red. This is because there are many more primary and process elevators with smaller capacities than there are export elevators with much larger storage. In the Histogram tab, we can click Load Values to assess the distribution of data and value ranges, which informs the most appropriate mode to apply. So here, given most features are in our first class, we'd want to apply a different mode, in this case a quantile equal count, so that an equal number of features are in each value range. So we still want to edit the value ranges to be more intuitive, double-clicking and entering the new values, which should also update the legend values. So we'll alter to 5,000 and 50,000. We'll also alter the legend values for upper and lower bounds, switching to greater than 50,000 and less than 5,000. Clicking Apply and looking in the canvas, there's a much better distribution of color across the features, which is reaffirmed back in the Histogram tab, where features are more evenly distributed across the value ranges. For point and line geometries, we can also alter the size of symbols between ranges to enhance visualization. So let's increase the size of the point symbol by 0.5 for each value range. Then clicking Apply and OK. So as seen within the map canvas, this offers a visualization of differing storage capacities between individual elevators. There are three additional symbology styles for point geometries. So we can apply a point cluster symbology, and within the render settings, see that our graduated symbology style is still applied. The cluster style will provide a dynamic count of features based on the scale of the canvas and specified distance, determining the radius for clustering. As we can see, zooming out, the counts of clustered features become larger, and zooming in, we can begin to see individual features. The point displacement symbology is effectively the same as the cluster, but depicts the individual features displayed in a particular geometry around the cluster. Additionally, features can be labeled using a specified field, here using the capacity ton field. As shown, this style is not best for detailed datasets or coarser scales, but is suitable when the features are sparser or the canvas is at a finer scale, enabling the properties and attributes of individual features to be distinguished within the cluster. So the final style is the heat map, which will create a dynamic raster style interpolation according to the spatial distribution of points. So let's switch the color ramp to red, yellow, greens, and then re-expand the dropdown to invert the color ramp. Additionally, we can weight the visualization by a numeric field. We'll use the capacity ton field as the weight parameter, clicking Apply and OK. Zooming in and out, we have a dynamic visualization of storage capacity that changes with scale. Now perhaps we want to alter the color ramp, because in this case, green areas effectively mean zero storage capacity. Rather than re-expanding the dropdown, click on the color ramp itself. Now we can edit the color gradient relative to the value ranges, or change the transparency for only one color by clicking on the stop and altering the opacity slider. Now back in the canvas, we can now see our underlying boundaries along with our heat map. Finally, we'll save the project file as, giving it a name, calling it Vector Visualization, so that we can use it in our follow-up video, in which we'll cover the rule-based symbologies and labeling schemes.